Hello, everybody. We are back. Y'all are listening to Media Ciphers only on 89.1 WIDR or online at widerfm.org. I'm going to be joined any moment by our co-host, Lawrence. We're going to talk about a couple of different topics here. And I think actually here comes Lawrence now. Waiting for him to hop into Zoom. Lawrence, how are you doing today?
Hello, hello.
Yeah, we can hear you. Hold on just a sec. Actually, hold on just a sec. Make sure. All right, go ahead, Lawrence.
Yo, what's up? Yo, what's up? Mic check. 1, 2, what is this?
Yeah, I can hear you, and so can the people of Kalamazoo. Glad to get you on the show for a little bit. So we got a pretty packed episode today, so, you know, me and Nora are going to jump on some topics later, and then we're going to do a really critical Black History segment. I wanted to open, though, Lawrence, so, you know, we had some breaking news that kind of came down before we started recorded for the broadcast today. And something that's on everybody's minds who've been paying attention to the atrocities going on in Gaza, a U.S. Air Force veteran, Aaron Bushnell, recently set himself on fire at the Israeli embassy in Washington, D.C., in protest of what the Israeli government is doing to the citizens of Gaza. Before we kind of describe exactly what happened, Lawrence, I talked a little, gave a couple of my initial thoughts at the top of the show, but any like just immediate responses to this, you know, this kind of, you know, it's a tragic anytime we see somebody, you know, principled organizer or activist pass away, and you know, this very intentional kind of suicidal action. And you know, I kind of talk about the politics of that, but it was very brave and very tragic. And I think something that should be mentioned is his life could have been saved if local law enforcement listened to first responders, but We'll dive into that in a second. Just what are some of your initial reactions, Lawrence?
Yeah, watching that video was tough. It is a act of extreme protest. It's very similar to when correct me if I'm wrong, but Buddhist monks set themselves on fire to protest the Vietnam War. It is an extreme form of protest. The misunderstanding, watching the video and the misunderstanding of the first responders and the police officers, either the security or the police officers who ran over to the guy with guns, and you can hear the paramedics and some of the first responders saying, "We don't need guns, we need water." Right? Like, I think it says a lot when active service members of our military would do this extreme form of protest instead of our government listening to the soldiers and or listening to the majority of their constituents and wanting a ceasefire. The man says in his video while he's walking up to the consulate that he does not want to participate in a genocide and he cannot be complicit in the genocide. And while he was doing his protest, he was saying free Palestine. The thing that made me the most upsetting, the thing that made me the most upset about the whole ordeal when it came to this brave serviceman was the media's implicit. I feel like it's implicit. I feel like it was actively embracing ignorance on why he chose to do so. So there was some people who talked about this. Shout out to Kyle Kalinske from Secular Talk, but he reposted a bunch of the news articles that just completely erased why this man was doing what he was doing. Like the New York Times, the headline says, "A man sets himself on fire outside of the U.S. embassy," the police say. Reuters, U.S. Airman sets himself on fire outside of the embassy. None of them give them the context of why. CNN Politics, same thing. Washington Post, same thing. They all erase the reason why he's doing so to just be like, oh man, this guy set himself on fire. Nobody knows why he chose to do so. Our media
Yeah, I'd
truly
on
wanted
that
to ignore
note point out
that.
otherwise considered kind of a liberal publication, Huffington Post, their initial article. And keep in mind, literally this man's live stream, it literally starts with him saying, "I am about to commit an extreme form of protest." And in HuffPost's initial article, they said officials did not say whether the self immolation was a form of protest. Now that's not even sloppy journalism. Like, that is intentional. The burying
That
of
is
the leader
journalistic
is absolutely
malpractice.
intentional. And it is journalistic malpractice. There's also a clip from MSNBC, which caught my attention and my ire, really. They're referring to the story as, well, one, they frame it as a young service member commit suicide in response to the Israel-Hamas war, which, we've talked about this a lot on the show. At this point, it is not a war. It is the IDF basically indiscriminately killing civilians in mass. You don't call that a war. You call that a genocide.
Just a quick note. Sorry to interrupt. The U.S. assistant, the UN's assistant, on human rights. I forgot the man's name. He had an interview, and he was saying the IDF has a higher kill rate of civilians than the Rwandan genocide in the 1990s. If you remember the movie Hotel Rwanda or that genocide that happened in Rwanda, they're saying that the IDF's kill rate is as high as the genocide that took place in 1994. If you haven't seen Hotel Rwanda and that movie, that's amazing. But if you don't know that story, it is ridiculous. When you have a kill rate as high as another genocide or higher, you're doing a genocide.
No, absolutely. And if we're on the subject of disturbing statistics, an average of about 160 children are killed every day, based on figures from the Palestinian Ministry of Health. And on average, if you want to compare that to Auschwitz on average killed 132 children a day. So they're literally outpacing the Holocaust at this point. And I know it's a lot of people, it's kind of ghoulish to make that comparison, but when you've kind of seen like kind of a turn on that in recent weeks, because they've been so speaking about the Israeli government, have been so open in their rhetoric and their actions about what they are doing that, I mean, the comparison just kind of presents itself. I also wanted to reference, going back to that MSNBC clip. So they reference it presented as young man commits suicide in response to Israel Hamas war, and then they go on to say, they completely kind of cut out the political context of why he did what he did. And then they ended the segment by posting something up about the suicide hotline. Now, it is important to note that, like, again, something that, part of his quote that I will never forget, and I might even open every show from now on with this one. This is what our ruling class has decided will be normal. And there's also that famous quote, it's like, there's nothing, and I'm kind of paraphrasing, but there's nothing to be too proud of or to be, to be well adjusted in a sick society. And while, from like an organizer's perspective, I would encourage people, particularly in an American context, revolutionary suicide and that type of thing, that's the expectation that we might at some point have to, die or be martyred for our beliefs. It's not necessarily to actively seek it out. At the same time, this is a tactic that, as you referenced earlier when we're talking about, principled religious martyrs have taken up this tactic over the years. And it's maddening to see so much of the mainstream media try to paint this as like a mental health issue or something to speak to the broader problems of like suicide rates in this country when, history, the way history views, say, like the monks that you referenced who set themselves on fire to protest the Vietnam War, history has fairly judged, their actions as being, this very extreme but morally principled response to the carnage that they were witnessing. I think history will look on Aaron the same way. And people in the mainstream media who are trying to paint this or obscure it in whatever way should be really just deeply ashamed of themselves for what they are doing to this man's memory.
I absolutely agree, 100%. The man, I am saddened. I, as a Christian, as someone who cares about who's a humanist in it when it comes to their politics, and as someone who just cares, I'm saddened that this soldier decided that the best way he could express his the best way that he could express his dismay and he could actively resist against American foreign policy was to do this to himself. I am saddened that that was the solution that he chose to go with.
And
I'm, I yeah, that's just what it is. I want our government to be more proactive in listening to our soldiers and the civilians instead of things like this happening.
I do just want to point out, and I know we already referenced this, but really put a fine point on this, is the response of law enforcement really was that was a microcosm not only of the genocide going on in Gaza, but just like that is America in just a tiny little bite, because you had these the responding officers, the responding police officers, literally looking at a man who has chosen to burn himself, set himself on fire, literally his last words screaming out "Free Palestine," and their response is to point a gun at him and tell him to get on the ground. There was reports one of the officers said, "Get on the ground, you effer," while EMTs are demanding and yelling at the cops to go find some fire extinguishers.
Yeah, we don't need guns, we need fire extinguishers.
Yeah.
They literally are yelling
Yeah.
that.
And like the real tragic thing is like Aaron could be here with us today. He could be explaining his actions from a hospital bed. But because law enforcement responded in really the most American way possible, Aaron is no longer with us, and now a family mourns, and a country mourns. And I will say, sometimes we can get very cynical, and it's, the ruling class isn't going to think twice about Aaron Bushnell, but his actions, I think, are really going to reverberate in a really strong way. There's, as has been pointed out, after the initial incidents, a lot of media was kind of forced to present this story. You actually heard Aaron Bushnell's words said out loud on CNN. So, his death is not going to come in vain, despite, the corporate media's best attempt to kind of make that so. And it's also demonstrated there's been a tremendous response from the Arab world and the Palestinian diaspora, who they really feel seen, and they really feel that revolutionary empathy. That, while they're, again, we've seen protests across the country, and some of the biggest pro-Palestinian protests in history coming out here in the United States. To see a service member come forward and say, "I am sorry, our empire is wrong, what we are doing is wrong, and I am willing to put my body on the line in order to show you like how I feel about this." There's somebody summed it up really well on the media platform formerly known as Twitter. They said, "If an American soldier sacrifices himself in an illegal war in Iraq, Syria, Afghanistan, or Libya, Western media will celebrate him as a hero. But if an American soldier sacrifices himself while protesting a US-funded genocide, Western media will dismiss him as mentally ill."
Yeah, I mean, our government has there have been there's a long history of men and women in the armed forces doing protests of various kinds, especially during like the Vietnam War and other things like that. Please do your research, do your Googles. We don't have a lot of time to get into it, but I encourage you to do so. This man will is and it is in good company, is it is good company of Americans who chose to use their voice to want to better a situation.
Absolutely. We'll link to some pertinent articles. There's a good article from Common Dreams that kind of sums up both what Aaron did and some of the media response to it. So we've got about, so Lawrence, I'm sorry, we don't have a ton of time. We got a lot to pack in today's episode, but we do have about 10 minutes before we can transition back to me and Nora's segment. There are a few things in the chat that I know we have kind of been bouncing around. Is there anything that you really wanted to speak on? Maybe some quick hits in the time that we have?
Is there some quick hits? I mean, yeah, I have a few quick hits. The primaries today, Michigan primaries today. And there's been a lot of news around our primary. I don't know if you saw Michael Moore's interview on CNN and MSNBC, but Michael Moore and other prominent political commentary, political figures like Rashida Tlaib and others, speaking out about voting non-committed, in today's primary, as a form of protest in the Democratic primary, to show our ruling elite and our staff in the establishment, in our political figures that are in power, that they may end up staying home if things do not change. And that is not a good sign for the general. That's not a good sign at all. I haven't voted yet. I still don't know how I'm gonna vote today. But and I wanted to speak on that because I thought that was a very interesting and pressing issue.
Unmute myself, sorry. So,
Yeah.
I'd also point out there's a really great article from The Nation that kind of describes the whole a little bit more in depth than even like me and Nora touched on this a little bit, but not in real depth. And that article from The Nation kind of sums it all up really, really well. I'll point people to it. It's Michigan's Uncommitted campaign is challenging Biden. It could also save him. And it kind of talks a little bit. They interview Andy Levin as well, kind of talking about this idea that Biden absolutely needs to pivot on this if he wants to win Michigan. And if he doesn't win Michigan, he's probably going to lose the election. There's very few scenarios where he could get reelected and lose Michigan. So, you have people. Really, and a lot of people within the Michigan Democratic Party. I know we're kind of used to talking about the pro-Palestinian stance as something that's like outside of the norm of the corporate Democratic politics, but I think there's a lot, the confluence of just how atrocious the genocide is, and the fact that the base of the Democratic Party, which has been continuing to go leftward on this. They really cannot reconcile voting for somebody who has enabled one of the worst ongoing genocides of the 21st century. They just can't. And unless the Biden administration does something really drastic between now and election day, it's probably going to sink him. And even the argument that yes, we all know Trump is worse. And I think you don't have to be a liberal or I think most socialists, communists, anarchists understand this as well. Different playing field, worse playing field. But it's genocide, it's described to me, this isn't a political issue, it's a moral issue. And moral issues hit a lot different than just oh, who has a different policy platform. Yes, it's true, Trump would probably be even worse about the genocide going on in Gaza, but genocide zero, a genocide, diet genocide is still genocide. And it's not the type of thing that you can force a lot of people, especially people who have families who have been killed over in Gaza. You can't tell them to go vote for the lesser evil. That hits a lot different than, that argument hits a lot different when we're talking about thousands and thousands of dead civilians and dead children. So yeah, I personally commend people like Andy Levin and Rashida Tlaib for trying to steer things a little better,
Just to add a little bit to that, recent polling has showed that a overwhelming majority of Americans, and it breaks down by Democrats, Republicans, Independents, and an overwhelming majority of American Jewish citizens want a permanent ceasefire in Gaza. I'm looking at Data for Progress. Data for Progress. This is in December. This is Data for Progress. Over 76% of Democrats, 57% of Independents, and 49% of Republicans are calling for Americans to do a permanent ceasefire and de-escalation in Gaza.
Yep. It's one of those that we talk a lot. We talk about this a lot, how the influence of money in politics mean, a lot of times it means that to there's that Stanford study that the actual will of the majority of American people has a near zero correlation to how Congress actually votes. And there hasn't been such an obvious case of that, or thing to point to in a long time, where we have a vast, vast majority of Americans who are saying, "Stop the carnage now," while Congress is busying itself writing like anti-BDS bills and echoing the talking points of fascists and the Israeli government, rather than what their constituents actually want. And again, it's a slim majority of Republicans too, where even people who have been kind of grown up, to be like pro-Israeli as a principle, see what's going on in Gaza and understands that it is wrong.
Absolutely. It is it goes back to the point of what you were talking about. Even in the I'm looking at USA Today, and ISUP data highlights a majority of Muslims, but interesting, over half, what was interesting, I'm reading from the article, what's interesting is that half of Jews also support a ceasefire when breaking down by political parties and religion. The numbers increased to 70 increased by both Jewish Democrats by 57% and Muslim Democrats by 78%. So that's a majority of Jewish Democrats and an overwhelming majority of Muslim Democrats that want a ceasefire. And the reason why I'm breaking that down as in just Democrats is because it's the Democratic Party that, as of right now, controls the funding that goes to Israel. If we want a actual ceasefire, in my opinion, this is my own opinion and my speculation, if we were to tell Israel, "Ayo, y'all not getting another dime, not another bomb, you're not getting any more support until you truly come to the table for a peaceful resolution." Because not only is this harming my political chances here in my own country, but you're hurting your stance around the world. The rest of the world's looking at you like monsters. Because what you're doing is a monstrous act.
Absolutely. And I think Lawrence, we'll probably wrap things up from there, but please join again, everybody, keep sorry, stay tuned. We've got a lot more on today's episode. Me and Lawrence will be back, maybe not next week, but the week after. I know spring break's coming up, so we might just pull some stuff from the archives. Lawrence, thanks for joining me on this unusually warm afternoon here in
Yeah.
Michigan. As I
There
said,
is something there. We're going to record something. I know that we had a talk, we're going to talk about Dr. Umar, because he came to campus, and that's an interesting conversation. We can record afterwards and have a conversation about that and a few other topics. But I wanted to talk about those things because that's happening today. Go out and vote. Please go vote. That's all I gotta say. Just go
Enjoy
vote.
the sunny day and try not to think too hard about how it correlates with our impending climate doom. But but in any case, we're gonna take a quick little break. I'm gonna come back, me and Nora. I think the next thing we're gonna talk about, we got some positive developments from Wisconsin, and then we're gonna talk about some more dour stories about the state of trans rights. Keep your dial locked. This is Media Ciphers only on 89.1 WIDR or online at widerfm.org, your only source for political revolution.
All right, OMG.